Thank you for the kind introduction. I would also like to thank University of Maribor for the invitation to this outstanding conference. It's both a pleasure and a honor being invited here. This brings me to my first question. When you look at the, or when I had a look again at the conference program yesterday, I was a little bit scared how my talk is going to fit into this excellent conference. On the other hand, when I had a look at the conference booklet, you know, this is all about network, getting out of your box, getting connected with each other, then I was pretty convinced that I fit in, because my talk is about forming networks, forming collaborations, working together between industry, where I come from, and universities, where most of you come from. So getting out of your box and working together. And why do we do that? Because we want to come up with some innovations. As you all know, innovation is not only something new, innovation is also something new and bringing it to the market. So innovation is always being successful in the real world. So it's very clear that for innovation, you need two partners. First of all, you need the universities to get the new ideas from the universities. And of course, you also need the industry to bring these new ideas, to translate these new ideas into products, into processes, and to bring it to the market. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. Just a short agenda. I will give you a very, very short introduction to Monde, the company I come from, some terms and definitions. Sorry for that, but I'm trying to make it as short as possible. I will give you a short introduction to FLIRT, to flirting. I guess all of you know what a flirt is, but maybe after my talk you will look at FLIRT in a different perspective, I guess, or I hope at least. I'll talk about networks. I will give you two case studies, and I hope that there is a room for discussion during my talk or afterwards. So Monde in a nutshell, only one slide. What is Monde? Monde is, to say it simply, Monde is among the world's largest pulp, paper, and packaging producers. The official headquarters is in Johannesburg in South Africa, but the headquarters for Europe and many other countries in the world is located in Vienna, in Austria, so you can also look at Monde as some kind of an Austrian company. That's all about Monde. Now I will go right into terms and definitions, how we in industry nowadays work together with universities, with R&D centers, with partners. I guess most of you know about, at least know about the term open innovation. It's still a quite new term. It came into place roughly 10, 12 years ago. Nowadays, most of the collaborative and the long and mid-term strategic projects between industry and universities are running through this term open innovation. And open innovation means that you get ideas. You as industry, you get ideas in, ideas from the market, new technologies, patents, of course also very important ideas from universities, from your partners, from your suppliers, whatever. But what is very, very important for the open innovation principle is that you get ideas in, but you also have to get ideas out. So it's not a one way, it's not like a spider sitting in the net and you're gathering all the information and nothing is going out. Open innovation should always be a mutual exchange. So ideas are getting in and ideas also getting out. Unfortunately, there's only one arrow getting out here on my slide. There should be more arrows. So you're getting ideas in, you're getting ideas out, you're funding spin-offs. If you discuss it with your partners, if you discuss with university new ideas, maybe you will come up to totally new ideas, to totally new businesses. And here's the mouse. You can either, of course, approach existing markets, So this is more or less incremental innovation, or you can come up to totally new markets, which I colored in blue if you think of the blue ocean theory, of the blue ocean markets, markets which don't exist now, markets which you find together with your partners, and you can come up with completely new fancy things, and of course, together with your partners, also make a lot of profit. That's where really innovation takes place. So, universities and industry, of course, should and are working together. And so a few words about how does such a cooperation take place. In former times, it was most of the case, it was just a classical vertical cooperation, meaning that you have your suppliers and you have your customers. The suppliers are offering you something. The customers want something from you. Normally, the customers are just asking for lower prices, and that's it. But anyway, this is normally in former times like innovation took place. Nowadays, as I told you, according to the open innovation principle, you're working together with universities, with other R&D centers. You're getting new ideas in. So it's both a horizontal and it's a vertical mode of cooperation. That's a very interesting slide, I would say. It's an interesting paper from Rossi, quite recent, 2010. This is just one slide, of course, from this paper. Rossi made a very interesting and very comprehensive survey, and he found out that he could cluster the cooperations between universities and industry into four clusters. And this is again some out of the box. Here you can see university partners just sitting in the box and not getting out of the box. This is the lower cluster. They are just doing research, maybe it's public funded the research, but there's nearly no interference, there's nearly no cooperation with other partners from industry. Same can also be for industry. Research more or less performed into a company, not that much cooperation to the outside world. But interesting ones are these ones. This is more or less incremental, which meaning that the industry is closely working together with a university, normal contracts, which means that normally we are talking about a timeline from, let's say, half a year to 1 or 2 years. And here, that's what I'm really like, and this is what is mirrored by the open innovation principle. It's about the mid and long-term strategic research projects, which meaning that really industry and universities are sitting together, sitting on the same table, exchanging ideas, and together, maybe also with some public funding, if yes, it's nice, if not. You're also going on with that project, sitting together and coming up with these new ideas, which at the end of the day, we can foster innovation. Here we can bring up new ideas to the market. So this is the very interesting cluster, which of course means that at the university you always also have to sit the right people. Yeah? This cluster, there can still be some brilliant minds sitting at the universities, but if they are not open for exchange with the industry, industry cannot make any use of it. So you need both. You need brilliant heads, but they also have to interact with industry. So collaboration, cooperation is very, very important nowadays, and question is maybe, is it only nowadays, or was it also very important in the past? And there's a very nice article in Nature quite recently, really proving that cooperation was important even in the Stone Age. This is a study done in Africa, as you can see, from a tribe called Hadza. I'm not sure if I pronounce it correctly. They are located in Tanzania. They are hunter and gatherer You can see in this graph, different colors correspond to different band members. The squares are the male and the circles are the females. And the larger the symbols, the more cooperative are the individuals. And what you can see, one of the most interesting outcomes of that study, I would say, is that cooperative individuals tend to cluster with other cooperative individuals. Meaning, if you are cooperative, if you are also sharing food, whatever, you tend to surround yourself, you tend to work together, you tend to tie yourself to other individuals within your tribe, within your band, who are also cooperative. This is some also what you said about kindness. And of course, you can guess that people or individuals who are more cooperative are also individuals which are more successful. They can find more food, they have more children, they can defeat themselves more effectively against, for example, lions. So being cooperative was always key, not only nowadays, it was also key, I would say, in the Stone Age. And this co-development of cooperation together with the evolution of human beings, I think this is one of the key factors which made us to what we are today. So cooperation is key. Very interesting paper. Okay, back to nowadays. Cooperation is important for us. So we have to find a partner. Sorry, of course, this slide is from a male perspective. When you think about finding a partner, the first assumption, of course, yeah, as a male, finding a young, attractive lady, but of course, in industry, what we are looking really at is the Albert Einstein, the bright minds at the universities. And this is now where flirt as a tool comes into play. So how do you approach and how do you find those bright minds? Just a definition about flirting. I'm not going to read that, but if you just replace opposite sex by cooperation, and if you just replace reproduction by innovation, this is a perfect definition, I would say, of working together between university and industry. So how do you do that? I mean, a flirt. Everybody, I guess, in that audience has done some flirting, maybe in the past. Nowadays, of course, it's not that easy. Normally, many years ago, if you see a young, attractive lady sitting somewhere, and you're approaching her, and you say, oh, excellent, you're young, you're good-looking, you're attractive, I would like to marry you. Here's a contract, by the way. Just let's sign and let's go on. This is normally not the way it works, I can tell you. Yeah? The lady will run away. Yeah? You will never see her again. And the same, really the very same, is if you approach a partner. Don't come with a contract, which means don't come with a lawyer. Yeah? Just start talking, sharing ideas, getting into touch with each other. But no contacts. Always keep it on an informal, face-to-face status at that approach, at that stage. This is really a mistake, I would say, which I've also seen many times from other colleagues from industry who think that it is very important, even for the first meeting, to come with one or two lawyers. Yeah? And then, you know, what happens normally, the lawyers are talking and they just want to clarify this and that detail, and at the end of the meeting, 90% of the speech was occupied by the lawyers, and the outcome was nothing. So really keep it at the beginning of a meeting, of a project, in an informal way, like a flirt. So when you start a flirt, there are three basic attitudes. First of all, you must somehow get connected. Yeah? Which means, for example, you're sitting in the same, you're sitting side by side in the lecture hall. You must be somehow connected. Secondly,
you have to interact. Yeah? You have to start talking. If you're sitting next to an interesting partner and you don't say a word, yeah, there will be no interaction, there will be no collaboration, no chance. So you have to start interacting somehow. Chatting, sending an email, whatever. And last but not least, there should be some sharing something. Could be very easy things. You can start with the writer, or you can start sharing some ideas. You can talk about the conference in that case, some other things. So these three things, get connected, interact, and share something. This is normally the start of a successful flirting, of a successful partnership. This is, in principle, the same, but in a more formal way. We conducted together with some other industrial partners, about 15 industrial partners, a very comprehensive study. And we were asking our other colleagues in the R&D management how you manage your collaboration, how do you approach your R&D partners, how do you approach universities. And this is all summarized in that slide. Again, you can divide it in principle into somehow getting connected, which means, of course, you have to identify your partners, let's say at an event, at a congress. Maybe you know your partner from literature, from a progress event, whatever. You have to get in touch, which means you have to interact somehow, talk to each other, send an email, whatever. Very, very important, the personal meeting, as I told you. Don't keep it on a video conference or on an email level. Really, a face-to-face meeting. There's nothing how you can substitute such a face-to-face meeting. And then, which is here in red, the red circle, the idea generation, which means you're sitting together, you're sitting on the same table, you have a face-to-face meeting, you have a personal meeting, and you're sharing ideas. That's again where this out-of-the-box concept comes into play. As I told you before, if you have some university partners who are only doing their own research and they are not sharing any ideas, they are not bringing up any new ideas, you are very, very probably not going on to collaborate or to talk or to flirt with that partner. So this idea generation process, everybody brings up some ideas, has some suggestions, whatever. This is a very, very crucial point. And after that, then of course maybe some non-disclosure agreements can be signed, and you can go really into a project planning. You can make some contacts, and you go into the concrete project phase. One slide about networks. Talking a lot about networks today. There are two principal different kinds of networks. It's the weak and the strong networks, as it is called. Yeah? And here, this is where flirting starts. Just a weak network, which means, and weak in that case means, that you maybe meet your partner several times, but not very often in a certain period of time. So maybe you meet him once per year. Maybe for 10 years, I meet somebody once per year, which means I have some weak interaction. Maybe we know each other, but we are not really working together with each other. But if the flirt starts and if the flirt is successful and we find some common ideas, if we are sharing ideas, these bonds are getting tighter, we are getting connected, and at the end, you are forming a strong network. Strong network means that you have some concrete project you're meeting quite often, maybe every month, something like that, on a regular basis, and you're really working together. So to sum up, in principle, between industry and universities, there are three different types of collaborations. The one is the easiest one, but the most urgent one is this one. you're facing a problem in your, let's say, production line, you have a corrosion problem, the machine has stopped and you need really urgent help, and you call some people at university and say, okay, we need it now, please come today, costs don't play a role, come now and solve the problem. This is the urgent one. This is the operational one. As I told you before, normally it's half a year, 1 year, 2 years. We can look at on a contractual basis. And this, again, is the long, a little long-term project. Maybe you get some funding, some market funding, and you're doing a collaboration from a strategic point of view with the university, which also means, of course, that you don't have to be ready tomorrow. You don't need an output within half a year. You have a strategic idea where you want to go together with your partner or partners, and you follow the path, you follow this roadmap for the next years together. What about the timeline? Again, of course, it depends. Are we talking about this long-term strategic projects or the mid and urgent or short-term projects? Normally, when you talk about this strategic long-term projects, it means that 5 to 10 years in advance of implementation, you are meeting your partners, you are starting the flirt, you are starting to build up a weak network, you are exchanging ideas, which is more or less on the level, what is principle possible? What do we have for, what problems do we have in industry? What is the expertise at the university? What can the university group offer to the industry? Which ideas do you bring in? Maybe some completely fancy and new ideas. So where in principle can we go together? The next phase, the midterm phase, is more concrete, which means, can we really make it? Do we want it? Which means, does it fit into our roadmap? This is where really the concrete projects start. So a weak network, a flirt, is being turned into a strong network. And the last phase is, of course, the implementation phase, where the results of the project go into some concrete products, processes, which are being implemented and are hopefully successful at the market. So two case studies, just to visualize how such things work in practice. This is an employee network, in that case of Mondi. You can get just the different circles corresponding to different individuals. What is very important here is the more center this circle is, so the higher the centrality, the more this person is connected. So person, individuals here in the outer region are not that high connected as people are here in the central region of this network. And what was very, very interesting for us when we conducted that study was, if you now correlate this network, this degree of centrality of the individuals with the innovation, with the innovative spirit of the individuals. So if you now look at individuals being here in the center and you evaluate the ideas, the things which these colleagues contribute to new processes, to new products which are successful, then about 75% of their ideas are successful. And these persons here in the middle were highly connected, were highly collaborative, about 75% of their ideas are successful. So these are the innovative minds in a company. People in the outer region, only about 20 to 23% of their ideas were successful. So there's a very easy message out from this complicated network. The more you are networking, the more you are cooperating, the more you are collaborating, just with your colleagues, the more innovative you are. Which of course for a company means that you should foster such innovation, such collaboration, such meeting points. For example, the coffee machine, some free coffee, maybe some nice places to sit. Give the people some place and maybe also some time to sit together to discuss ideas. Don't cancel that. Normally, you know, when a consultant enters a company, he will immediately look at this, you know, colleagues who are just sitting and chatting, and he will tell you this is a waste of time. Cancel it. It's just the opposite. Colleagues who are more connected, who are working together, who have the time to chat to their colleagues, to share ideas, they are more innovative, and of course, at the end of the day, they bring more profit to the company. Another case study, a little bit technical on this slide. Just wanted to give you one concrete example. Here together with again, the university part in Austria, which is one of pigments based on nanotechnology, which change the color when they are red. So you have a different, you have one color when they are dry, and you have another color when you are getting into contact with water. I have a video here for you, just to show you the effect. This is real-time videos, and you can see an immediate color change. So what can you do with that fancy stuff? First of all, of course, school children like it. Also, some politicians and the Austrian broadcast television liked it. It's the world's fastest material which corresponds, which reacts to water contact, and it changes the color, which means it makes it able for you to detect water or humidity. And again, what you can see here is nowadays the network which we have built around that idea. The internal network within Monday, different groups within Monday, that's basically in the middle, and about more than 30 companies in the meantime who are participating in that network. So it's about 30 or even more different ideas who are being connected to this idea, to this nanomaterial, which just changes the color when getting into contact with water. So this is also a very nice example, I would say, for cross-industry innovation and for the open innovation principle. You have an idea, Monday and another partner, and you are sharing this idea with other universities and with other industrial partners, and there are a lot more ideas which are now coming up. Of course, you can also do this network analysis for 3 or 4 or 5 projects. Normally what we do is to do it at least for 5 or 10 projects, but in that case it gets very complicated to visualize it. But what is interesting, of course, for us as a company, the green circles are the internal, so the Mondi employees, and the red are the partners outside. What you can do is with such a network analysis, you can identify the project championships, the interfaces, which colleagues are connected to many projects. Some colleagues are only connected to one project, because normally in reality we can make it for 10 projects, and some colleagues are connected to all projects. So you can identify the most critical persons, the interfaces. So this network analysis is in the meantime also key for us as a management tool. So I'm nearly done. I hope I could show you that as it is called, open innovation is the basis for nowadays modern collaboration between industry and universities. There are different modes of collaboration, but they all need networks. Networks are the basis for that. A tool which you all need, which you all know, FLIRT, you can use that, if so slightly modified, of course, to come from weak to strong networks. I've shown you two case studies, and I would like to end with a two-mode network. Last slide. Here we analyze nine different events, and these are the companies who took place in the event. And again, you can see that some companies only took into one event, some kind of conference, some kind of innovation conference in Austria, and other companies took place in more or some in all of this conference, in these events, in this networking. And at the end of my talk, I would like to ask you a question. Please guess, where are the innovative companies, in the middle or in the outer region? Thank you for your kind attention.